Hello, and welcome to Harry Sullivan Is An Imbecile. I'm Adam.
And I am Brian.
So, Brian, what are we talking about today?
Oh, well, Adam, what aren't we talking about today? So, today, we are going to be discussing the BBC Centenary Special, The Power of the Doctor, which is Jodie Whittaker's last story, is packed with a lot of things. It's 90 minutes. We're probably not going to go 90 minutes because that would be ridiculous, but... So I went to a Flaming Lip show last week, and when I go to a Flaming Lip show, I scream my head off. So I'm still feeling some of the soreness in my throat, and you probably hear a bit of a rasp. So that's why I sound like a sexy Lauren Bacall or a not so sexy Brenda Vaccaro, if any of those names make a difference to you. But Jodie Whittaker's last story. So, you know, obviously all the emphasis is going to be on her. It's going to be a celebration of her era. It's going to answer every question we had about the Timeless Child and the Ghost Monument and all that. And, you know, I think by the end of this, everybody's going to be really satisfied with what they've learned of the Chibnall era and the Jodie Whittaker era.
Oh, you haven't actually seen it, have you?
No, man, first time. God, I can't wait to see it. No, I'm just kidding. Yes, I've seen it, and obviously I'm seeing it with my tongue firmly planted within my cheek.
So, how many times have you seen it?
I have seen it 3 times.
Okay.
And I'm going to start loading up my HBO, I'm sorry, my Max now, because HBO Max is no longer HBO Max, it's now Max. But... it is, I'm starting it up now, just to kind of have it playing underneath. So anything that does come up that I forget, as we discuss it, I'll remember it. We start off under training space. That's new.
Yes. So can I ask, has your opinion of it changed from the first time you saw it to the most recent watch?
Well, the first time I saw it, I was with... my girlfriend was with another friend who's a Doctor Who fan, brought me important coffee, and another friend, and at the time, I was just caught up in the spectacle of it, because, you know, you've got the return of Tegan, you've got the return of Ace, you know, it's, you have mad moments with Sacha Dhawan, that's really fun, you know, we get the doctors and all that, so just all this stuff that's happening, and so when I watched it, I kind of got caught up in that, and then when I went back to rewatch it, I'm like, yeah, you know, there are some characters we don't need, you know, we don't really need Dan, we don't need Vinder, but we'll discuss that as we go along.
Vinder, because it's too problematic to get John Barrowman back anymore.
Keep his dick in his pants.
But I've watched it twice now. I watched it when it's first aired, and then I watched it just last weekend for this. And I like you said, there's a lot of spectacle in the first time you watch it, and I was kind of aware of the flaws, but you know, after 3 years of Chibnall, you just kind of just go, yeah. Yep. Okay. Of course, whatever.
Does it come to this?
Watching it a second time, I was just like, oh, this is frustrating. I mean, I knew it was frustrating, but I was more frustrated the second time I watched it. Because if nothing else, and I'm not the first person to say this, but as Jodie's final story, she kind of gets sidelined for like a lot of it. Like, there's so much going on and there's so many people that she runs around. And then the master regenerates into her, and then she's literally, you don't see her again. Well, you see an AI, but you don't see her doctor until, like, what was it, 20 minutes later? And it's one of the things that, it's great, you know, you want to do a story about how the doctor influences people and brings out the best in them. That's fine. That's a theme that this new series has tackled on and off, and you know, it's not new territory, but you know, Doctor Who is a long-running program. You can return to certain themes and certain ideas, maybe put new twists on them, whatever. That's fine. But maybe not in the Doctor's final episode, when the emphasis really should be on them more than anything, I feel.
Yeah. Yeah, you really kind of... That's kind of the summation of the Jodie Whittaker era, the Chris Chibnall era, is that, you know, the focus is never put on 13. It's always, you know... you know, Tim Shaw, or it's, you know, or it's Yaz, or it's some other, or the Master. It's, you know, the Doctor, her Doctor, I felt never really, I feel like I liked her, but I really, if you were to ask me to say, hey, what's the 13th Doctor all like, I'm like, she's got a Yorkshire accent.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. No, it's difficult. I don't think the era itself ever quite agrees. It's not sure. Is she more empathetic? Is she more socially awkward? Yeah. I feel personally because of that, sometimes you end up in the situation where people are putting their own readings on it that just because they have to, kind of. I mean, yeah, it was in some ways a frustrating. There's fun stuff in there, but it was a frustrating watch. You know, it's great to see Tegan and Ace back, but maybe again, not two returning companions when there's so much going on.
Well, I can kind of understand it because it is, you know, a centenary special. Yeah. So. It is, you know, let's look at this from the BBC perspective, I guess. I don't know. but, you know, we have three major, you know, the Doctor's three major arch-nemesis, you know, the Master, Daleks, and Cybermen. You know, and then, you know, we bring back old Doctors, we bring back old companions. We kind of, you know, touch maybe some of the new era. So I think in, you know, just jamming all that in there is, you know, I think a lot to put. I mean, it's a 90-minute special, which, you know, is that like the longest modern era?
Oh, yeah, I think it is. Because Day of the Doctor is, what, 75?
Yeah, so, yeah, Day of the Doctor is like, you know, just over an hour. You know, End of Time, you know, it's 2 hours, but it's two episodes.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is, you know, this is like the first... You know, for me, growing up in the U.S., watching a 90-minute Doctor Who story is, you know, what I did growing up, because that's how they showed the classic series, is they showed them as omnibus. So length doesn't really bother me, but it's the curse of having a 90-minute story. You have so much stuff you want to fill in. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, it's as you say, you know, just as the episode gets rolling... You know, we're back to, you know, it's the focus is on the Master, and it's the Doctor Master, and it's yeah. So, for it being a celebration of the Jodie Whittaker era or the Chris Chibnall era, you know, it's all over the place. So, I guess that's kind of where we are.
true to the era, though.
Yeah,
and I mean, think
at least he's on point.
To go back to bringing in Tegan and Ace, there's a question of ultimately. Look, it's lovely to see them on screen again, you know, and
yes.
we'll probably talk about seeing Sylvester and Sophie and Davison and Janet on screen together. That, you know, that is lovely, but if you look at, say, School Reunion, obviously, or Death of the Doctor,
yes.
The Sarah Jane special, it's...
Yeah.
You know, so what I think the reason why the School Reunion works so well is that it is in some ways Sarah's story, or they use her to make a point about what happens when the Doctor travels or things. That there are thematic reasons for her to be in that story, and also they make sure that she gets so much time with not just with the Doctor but with Rose as well.
Yeah.
And
yeah, exactly. And so, yeah, so it's like she gets a chance to You know, we have a classic companion who gets a chance to be in the modern series. It's whereas, you know, and I don't know if this was what the point you were trying to make is, I think just bringing back Ace and Tegan was just for the fact of bringing back Ace and Tegan.
Yeah.
Not that I am, that I dislike that, because I thought they were freaking incredible.
But it's like when the Doctor sees them for the first time, it's interesting because she kind of looks terrified. And Yaz looks weirded out, even though Yaz has already met Captain Jack by this point. So she, you'd think she's probably at least used to the idea that the Doctor travels with other people. And I think it ties into a bit with, I feel there's a weird thing missing in this, and it's actually Thasmin. And look, we could do a whole episode about how that all got going and started, and how that started as a fan theory, and then was picked up by the production team, and they introduced it later, and whether it's good or bad, I don't want to necessarily go into that. But look at the end of Legend of the Sea Devils, you know, the preceding episode,
Do I have to?
No, it's not compulsory. But you know, they sit down, they have that talk, and it, you know, it's an interesting moment because the Doctor goes basically, oh no, can't we just be friends to keep traveling? Because that's really cool. I mean, not to the worst of those effect, but that's the general thing. She's like, oh no, I can't, I don't want, I, she doesn't say I can't, not really. She says she can't, but then she mentions a wife, so it's more like, I don't want to be in. Yeah, just, sorry, my partner's just appeared behind me and gone, I'm just not that into you, which is either a comment on what the conversation or she's breaking up with me live on this podcast. But, well, but yeah, it's basically that. And then, but then she's like, oh, but let's keep traveling because that's really great. And my thing is, If you had a friend who was in that position that Yaz is in, and they're like hanging out with someone, they told them how they feel, and that person went, "I'm not into you, but let's keep hanging out," you'd be like, "No, no, darling, you need to get some space now. You need for your own health." And
that is the plight of every high school boy that I know of.
Yeah,
I just want to be friends. I'm not gonna say. I don't, you know, I'm not a, I hate the term friend zone because I have my own, I have, because when you're saying things like, oh, I've been banished to the friend zone, you're still friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
friendship is,
but you know, that's a whole other conversation that we could have about, you know, gender roles and what is expected and all that stuff. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, for me, it's just a lot. I mean, you know, and it's like, you know, I've got it running right now, and you know, it's where Dan's like, you know what, I almost died out there, and I don't think I want to do this anymore.
Yeah,
which you don't often. I think what the closest we got with that was Tegan going, "It's no longer fun." Mm. When she left, or it stopped being fun.
Martha.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, well, shit, man. Martha is just sick and tired of him mooning over Rose. I'd want to leave that noise, too.
And I think, I think that's the thing, you know, I genuinely thought the Legend of Sea Devils, okay, there's more to this, to use the term Thasmin story, you know, because surely that you can't emotionally leave it there, that there's something, those characters are going to have to come to an understanding, because it becomes
there's going to have to be some sort of closure.
It inevitably would become an unhealthy dynamic, but it doesn't. And yeah, I mean, I bless him. I think John Bishop left early because he's a very busy man who does a lot of touring and stuff. So he's probably like, I can give you 3 days in the studio. So they were like, Andy, go. But I do quite like a companion going, you know what, this is actually insanely fucking dangerous. So I'm going. Okay, this has been fun, but it's also like, I'm off now.
This is above what I'm able to handle and being able to sleep at night. But
I'm a man in my late 40s. My back hurts, and I don't want to do this anymore. It's an absolutely solid good reason to not travel with the Doctor anymore.
My back hurts. I'm out of here.
Yeah, basically, I just should have gone. You know what? I've trouble bending down, and I have to keep ducking to avoid Dalek fire, and it's doing my back in.
I can't run anymore because my hip locks up. And
my feet hurt. Well, these shoes aren't comfortable enough.
I'm tired, and there's this show I've been wanting to watch on on streaming that.
all valid,
valid reasons not to. Yeah.
Yeah, all valid reasons to not travel the Doctor, but
exactly.
But yeah, I think it's because it's such a manic episode, and it kind of plays into that, that your Doctor's doing one thing, then the other, but it just means there's no, like, what we saw in Legend of I was going to say Legend of the She-Devil, which is a, I think it was a TV thing starring Tom Baker.
What, the Lives and Loves of a She-Devil?
Yeah, that was the one, but... thank you. yeah. A very different episode. But Legend of the Sea-Devils, that's essentially it for Thasmin. Everything else, I heard somebody else commented on it, that they basically take Thasmin out, and then for Power of the Doctor, they put it back in the closet. And that's stuck with me a bit, because it suddenly all flips back to subtext that you have to look for if it's there. I often would be Chibnall. I often think of the Garth Marenghi quote of, "I know writers who do subtext, cowards, all of them." Because I, in the nicest possible way, I'm not saying he doesn't have themes or even to an some extent character arcs, but they're all stated up front. Like, there's no.
Yeah,
like,
he is. Yeah, Chibnall. From all I've seen is obviously his stuff on Doctor Who, and then Broadchurch. But yeah, he doesn't do themes. He doesn't do foreshadowing. He doesn't do stuff like that. It's all just, you know, I'm telling a story, and so yeah. So as you say, with things like Thasmin, it all comes back going to, you know, subtext, and you know, it's almost like, you know, we're watching a movie from the 1940s and. Or 1950s, and watching Rock Hudson and some other actor, and going, "Oh, okay, did they or didn't they?" So
yeah, and I think for me, I genuinely think also, as far as he's concerned, that's all been dealt with. You know, Legend of the Sea Devils, that's done now. So yeah, I mean, we're skipping right to the end, but I have to talk about it early on. I mean, I feel sorry for Yaz. She does, because in terms of like representation and the actress, she's such an important. First for Doctor Who, and she gets possibly one of the worst companion leavings in the modern series, where the Doctor goes, "I'm going to regenerate, you better go," which, yeah, I mean, you could emotionally play that in some ways, but also then she's hanging out with companions who have seen that. I mean, if she has a conversation with Mel, that's going to be awkward, but you know, it's just literally like they can't find a way to write it out. Like, I went into this honestly thinking she might die, like, that's all I could think, because I couldn't think of thematically what journey she has. It's either a relationship with the Doctor or going, actually, this isn't healthy for me, so I should go. But no, the Doctor just goes, "Look, could you just leave?" I mean, people have come up with some amazing headcanons for this era, because I think they feel they have to.
This is going to be awkward, and I don't want you to see this, because I don't know what kind of person I'm going to be. And, I mean, literally at the time, didn't know what kind of person that they were going to turn into, because they hadn't chosen the next Doctor at the time.
Yes.
It's so emotionally flat.
Mm.
No, flat would be giving it some depth, but it's just, Thasmin is not able to, she doesn't defend herself, she doesn't try to put up a fight about it, she doesn't say, "Hey, look, I've been with you through this, you know, why can't I be with you through this last thing, you know, we've been through it." It's just, okay, you know, "I'm regenerating, you gotta go, bye."
Yeah.
Bye!
I mean, honestly, it might as well have had the Doctor wake up and find a note from Thasmin gone, "I've gone to save my aunt in the country to recover, goodbye." Because I can't imagine being a Thasmin fan and finding that satisfactory. Like, I don't know. I mean, it's something that's caused a lot of discourse and debate, and I don't, you know, really want to get into it, but it must be frustrating, right? Like, I can't, like, look, I'm an Ace and Seventh Doctor fan, so I'm frustrated we never got a Sophie Aldred leaving on screen. And so I understand that frustration, but I think I'd rather not ever see her leave on screen and have at least some ambiguity about it than the Doctor said. Doctor's going, "Look, could you just go? Look, I'm literally regenerating to make you leave now. So could you please go?" You know?
Oh man, what a reason to break up with someone. It's not you, it's me. I'm changing into someone else. I'm literally changing into someone else. Yeah, and we're not gonna. I'm fine if we don't keep linear to the story, because I feel like we're gonna be jumping back and forth towards a lot of things. But the scene at the end with the companions, with all the other companions, is a fantastic moment. But at the same time, you're sitting there going, okay, well, this is as good as Yaz is gonna get. This is. She's never going to get the quote-unquote closure that she wants. Mm-hmm. Instead, you know, she's going to be, you know, talking in this room full of strangers, all of whom seem to be the really old ones. I don't think we see Martha in there. Or,
No,
we don't see Martha. Who else would be
obviously...
a modern series? What modern series companion? I'm blanking. I mean,
no. The
I mean, Graham. Graham's there.
Yeah,
Graham and Graham, Dan, and Yaz are like the only new series, modern series companions that you see there.
Ryan. Ryan isn't there because I think Tosin Cole. I don't know if I've said this before, but Tosin Cole was wasted by the series in the end. And I think he knew it, and also I think he's actually doing very well for himself at the moment.
Quite so.
And rightly so. I think he's a great actor. I think we'll really look and go, oh, he didn't get what he deserved. And so he's obviously like, just like, no, I'm not coming back.
I could just see Graham going, come on, Ryan, let's go, Ryan, come on, it'd be a laugh.
But yes, it's, but it's you know, one of the most, just from a metatextual point of view, one of the most interesting things about that scene is the fact that Mel, or more importantly, Bonnie Langford's there. Because, you know, as people pointed out, you know...
How?
Yeah, you know. But she's there because... And this is funny, given the reception she got when she first joined the series. In terms of classic companions, she is probably one of the most well-known outside the Doctor Who circles. Just because she's had such a long career, she's kept going, she's done so much. She was working all the time. And
what was the series? She was a series as a child. What was it called?
Just William.
William. Yeah.
But since then, as well, then, like we had a, you know, the show The Masked Singer. We had a spin-off here called The Masked Dancer, and everyone was saying, "Oh, this one person's Bonnie Langford." I was like, "That's not Bonnie Langford, because excellent dancer. There's no way Bonnie Langford, at the age she is, can still get her leg up that high." No, it was Bonnie Langford. But that's my point: is that she's recognizable enough that they would put her on a popular show like that and not rely on the Doctor Who connection. There was like one clue, obscure clue that when I heard it, I was like, oh no, it must be. But do you know what I mean? Like she is, given the hatred that a lot certain fans had for her when she came on, the fact that now she's at that stage where it was actually in the news that she was coming back as well, the newspapers, you know, no one else, you know, they didn't mention like, you know, Janet Fielding or Sophie Aldred or William Russell, but Bonnie Langford got a bit of press. I just find that really fascinating. Like, that's the essential reason she's on there, because
and for me, I mean, my Bonnie as a companion, or Bonnie Langford as a companion, if you judge her, I think a lot of people just judge her by Delta and the Bannerman, I think a lot of people judge her by Time and the Ranny, which is where she is just a ridiculous screamer. It's like the one where, there's a pterileptal standing right in front of her, and she screams, takes in a breath, and screams again. You know, just moments like that. And then, I think she was getting better, but, you know, it was obvious that, you know, there was really nothing beyond... I mean, there was no depth to that particular character as they were... As she was said to be, which is a computer programmer from Peace Pottage, to whatever it was that she turned out to be. And then she goes off with Glitz. And then now we have to reconcile some sort of headcanon where she makes it back. You know, she not only doesn't get screwed by Glitz, either figuratively or literally, or maybe literally, but, you know, figuratively. But, you know, she's able to get back to Earth and still want to be a part of this group. So, but I also think, you know, I am going to shout out to Big Finish, because Big Finish does what they always do, and that's they kind of take these characters and just rehabilitate them. You know, like the Sixth Doctor has become an entirely different, you know, a beloved character since Big Finish has taken, you know, he's joined Big Finish. And, you know, the few stories that Bonnie Langford has been, you know, she's not, you know, the annoying character that we find on the TV series. But yeah, it's so, let's see, who's there? So it's Bonnie Langford, it's Katie Manning, mm-hmm. William Russell.
Mm-hmm. Technically, you could have Polly, but apparently Annika Wills was sorting out a tree. That's what I heard, like, she was having a tree removed or something, so she wasn't available.
Oh my god.
Which is hilarious for some reason.
So I'm gonna, this, and this isn't something, I don't know, I'm probably not gonna put this in a podcast, but Jake Ingalls, who was part of the Flaming Lips at one time, and he has his own band called Space Face, but he and I talk quite a bit. And they had recently, when the Flaming Lips did this really amazing series of concerts where they put themselves and then the audience in these giant plastic bubbles. And somebody did a documentary on it. And this was around the time Jake was leaving. And Jake's excuse, he's not in the documentary outside of, like, concert footage. And his excuse for not doing the documentary is because he didn't want to wake up that early in the morning.
I can just imagine going, I'm sorry, darlings, I can't make it. I have a tree to remove. Send my best.
All right. Okay. Let's see. How far are we into
what
this?
What they should have had, though, is Nicola Bryant sitting there with Brian Blessed next to her. Just like, but Brian Blessed in the full 80s costume and makeup still, and just maybe like trying to fight Dan and Graham or something, you know. It's like,
from Renee!
Renee! Body slam.
I am King Carlos, and this is my beautiful queen, Perry. I can speak for myself. Yes, isn't she a fireball?
Oh, well, missed opportunities. I mean, I appreciate there was, you know, there is a... It is a
there was an effort made.
Yeah, and it is a little bit who's available. Like, again, Freema, yeah, Martha's not there, because she's a busy actress. She's in lots of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, she's in a lot of U.S. series or has been. and then William Russell, who rumors I've heard is that he's not well, I guess?
I mean, he's very old. Like,
he's 90-something, 95? Yeah,
like, I think there was a little rumors that maybe he was confused on set, and people were like, ooh, is that elder abuse? And look, as someone whose mother has Alzheimer's, I get that concern. Like, I was like, ooh. But they have said, you know, Chibnall and a few others were interviewed at Gallifrey 1 recently. I think they were like, you know, he was allowed to, he went for breaks. His daughter was there. They were very like, sure he was as comfortable and made sure he was okay to be there. So it's like, yeah. I hope he was, you know, it was lovely to see. It was a moment to see him. I mean, God knows what anyone else made who didn't know who he was, but you know.
Yeah. Well, and speaking, having gone through my own experience with dementia, I don't know. It's, for me, when you have somebody who has dementia, you can see it. You can, because there's, I don't know if you're experiencing this, but I did with my father, there's something to their eyes that it's kind of like an unfocused look, that for me is always kind of the, oh, okay, well, you know, I don't think they're sure where they are. you know, I saw it when Terry Jones did the Lifetime Achievement Award, right as, you know, it was announced that he had the aphasic dementia, which apparently is what Bruce Willis has as well. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, but yeah, it's, the fact that he's there is freaking amazing. And I think, you know, just having him there and you know, obviously he's good enough to do the lines. Mm-hmm. He's got a much better delivery than William Hartnell did in The Three Doctors, but you mm-hmm. know, it's not like he's reading them off cue cards, so I get that concern. I get that concern with him being as advanced in his age and all that. So but anyway.
But I think something about the companion support group is, again, we talk about Jodie's doctor being overshadowed in her own finale, but then Yaz gets overshadowed in her own leaving, because it's like you said, it's just like she's there, but of course, for at least for a certain segment of the audience, we're all like, holy shit, it's so and so and so and so and so and so, and for everyone else, it's just like
she's like everyone else,
she's just standing around. And I'm like, and also I'm a little bit wary about the idea of Kate just going off and recruiting .x companions and stuff. I'm a bit like, I don't know. I always prefer it when the Doctor's relationship with Unit is a little bit spiky, and it's not especially spiky in this era. So, which is is not this a particular folk just for the zero, you know. It's it always depends a bit on the writer and stuff, but I'm a bit like, all right, Kate.
Well, I think it's because you're
recruiting this 90-year-old man to go and infiltrate a Dalek base.
I can't feel my legs. Anyway, yeah, that is, and it's really interesting because, you know, she's supposed to be, Kate Stewart's supposed to be sort of a, not really a dramatic relief, but, you know, a departure from her father, who is a military, head of military, you know, mindset, where she's supposed to have more of a science mindset. So, you know, science leads. But, you know, she's more than willing to, you know, want to blow up the world and...
Yeah, the science mind...
And recruit 50, 60-year-old, you know, former companions to do unit work.
For some reason, I was just going to say, I imagine that they were saying who else could have been at that companion meeting. I imagine production staff were having to physically restrain John Levine from bursting in at all times. bless him.
Not my doctor. I'm going to smash a TV.
John Levine, not Ian Levine.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, shit.
I was going to say, that's a bit harsh on poor John there. Oof. I don't think he's ever smashed the telly. But he's probably got a story about having smashed the telly, though.
Yeah, so let me make a note of that time. 3140-something. 3140-something. Okay, cool. I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. No.
I've been kind of going through all my old Doctor Who stuff, and a lot of it is the old Doctor Who bulletin, which then became Dreamwatch bulletin, and just the amount of vitriol that they had towards the John Nathan Turner era, and oh my god.
Do you ever think about how the Leisure Hive destroyed Gary Lee? I mean, I think about that quite often. How, like, even in the John Nathan Turner autobiography I got, Totally Tasteless, he's there as going, I watched Leisure Hive. It's like, quite near the end, he's like, I watched Leisure Hive, I knew something was wrong. I was like, so you spent the next 10 years writing just this, being so angry just because I quite like Leisure Hive. I don't think it's ever driven me to that extreme, but
I mean Leisure Hive is, you know, obviously it's a marked departure from what we had before, and just because something's different doesn't mean it's better.
Bickett, why is this opening shot so long? I want to drive a teenager mad.
Oh, look at that. We can see a ceiling. Cool.
Somewhere teenagers snap their pens in rage. Anyway, where were we?
I think we kind of got sidetracked by me misconstruing Ian and John Levine. Different spellings of Levine as well. Yeah, Sergeant Benton, that would be fun to see him in there. Although I don't think Richard Franklin is in good health.
No,
yeah,
not like, by most, yeah. not from what you hear.
Yeah, not from what you hear. And I hear a little bit, but not that much. But yeah, geez, you know, Benton, that would be so fun to see him there. You know, because Benton never got his proper goodbye.
No, I mean, I guess Benton's more of a supporting character than a companion, but
which kind of is what the direct-to-video spin-off.
Never seen Wartime, but I wouldn't mind giving it a go.
I would too. I mean, there's like this whole amount of 80s fan video ephemera that never made it over here to the US that I would just die happy just diving into. So I don't want to die, but you know.
I mean, I feel it says something about Power of the Doctor that we've got sidetracked into talking about real time and BBV videos,
and not about the episode.
Not the episode itself. Let me ask you a question: why is the Master in Russia, and why is he impersonating Rasputin? Is it just because he wants a big ballroom and likes Boney M? Because watching it again, I thought, well, there must have been an explanation about why it was Russia. No, there isn't.
No,
there isn't.
There's no reason for it to be Russia.
No, and it's...
There's absolutely no reason for it to be Russia. And if he has, you know, gotten rid of, you know, the original Rasputin, then does that mean that the revolution doesn't happen? Because, you know, a lot of the people would, I'm not a big Russian historian, being American, I don't want to be that anymore, or be there anymore. Oops, bit of politics there. you know, it was his influence, it was supposed to be his influence that was one of the seeds for the revolution.
Yeah, oh yes.
I mean,
yeah,
it's,
yeah, yeah.
You know, obviously it's the opulence of the Tsar and the Tsarina, obviously, but, you know, it's, yeah, so has the master actually killed Rasputin, which, if you know anything about the death of Rasputin, is a mighty deed. well, it's all there in the song Rasputin by Boney M. but yeah, I don't see a reason for him to be the Rasputin or Rommel or, you know,
I mean, if you just want to say, you could even just have him say, I enjoy dressing up, which is almost fine, but you're right, when he's a literal, actual historical figure that had genuine consequences, you know, I know this is Doctor Who, and we let certain things go, that's fine, Doctor Who, like all good programs, it has its own logic, its own internal world, but you are distracted by the fact that you're going, so what's happened to the, was there a real Rasputin? Have you been here all this time? Like, is that a fake beard? I mean, obviously it's a fake beard, but, you know, is it supposed to be a fake beard? This is it. I was talking to Eric from the Real McCoy, and we were chatting about it. And again, he was like, Rasputin's a genuine figure, so what's happened to history?
You know, exactly, like, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
It's a lot of people just like, okay. You could absolutely do the story about the master being Rasputin in Russia, but again, you need to have room for it, and it needs to be the focus. It can't just be because you're like, hey, remember that thing with the Scissor Sisters? Well, we're gonna do it with Boney M.
You know what, that makes more sense than any explanation as to why the Doctor would be, you know, disguising himself as Rasputin. There's an allusion to Tom Baker because he played Rasputin in Nicholas and Alexandra, but I think that's, you know, a very far-fetched connection. I think that's more coincidence than anything.
Can I just say, I know it was, you misspoke, but you said the Doctor dressing as Rasputin, and I picture Jodie in a big fake beard like a woman in Life of Brian. Just like,
oh my god!
Oh, hello, I'm definitely Rasputin. Which I think she'd have it's had.
Who threw that?
But they'd never give her anything that much fun to do, to be honest. So there we go.
So,
but I think.
Oh my god! So I have to make another edit there. So I need to.
No, keep it in. Keep it in.
Oh, okay. So keep that in there. So all right, fine. I'll take out this part.
But yeah, what do you make generally of Sasha's master?
I don't know, because I like Sacha Dhawan as an actor.
Oh, he's a great actor, yeah.
I think this is his best as the master. I loved the reveal that they did in Spyfall. I thought that was freaking fantastic. I like this version of the master for some reason, because I know a lot of people are upset because it's such a, you know, such a difference from where Missy ended up. So, and I've shared this idea with you before, but I'm going to expound on it now, that my thinking is that Sacha Dhawan's master is, you know, a reaction against Missy becoming as compassionate and kind as Missy ended up becoming, you know, to the end of even, you know, betraying themselves by, you know, stabbing, you know, the John Sim master. And so what the master is doing here, because towards the end of you know, the first Cyberman, Mondasian Cyberman story. Anyway, in that story, it's Missy has coming out and saying, I'm Doctor Who, you know, pretending to be the Doctor, becoming the person that the Master has hated the most, consistently hated the most throughout, you know, all the existences. And so I think Dewan's master is getting revenge on that by becoming, well, the doctor wants them to become the doctor. He wants the master to become the doctor, so the master will become the doctor, just not the doctor, you know, that you expect. So I see his master is more of a reaction against Missy, rather than being a pre-Missy master, because that doesn't make any sense to me. You know, I know a lot of us, me as well, adored Michelle Gomez as Missy, and loved, you know, especially, you know, World Enough to Time and all that, you know, and you know, just seeing the progression, how she turned the master from this, you know, especially in that last season, you know, becoming a more, you know, kind of kinder, benevolent, kinder, gentler master. But yeah, I can definitely see the Dewan master being the screw that. I'm the master, you know, how dare you? And then gets into the added madness of, you know, because of the whole timeless child thing, even though this is not really discussed in the episode, not even discussed at all. This is all my interpretation. Chibnall did none of this. This is me filling in all the gaps here.
And that's one of the major problems of this era. We're having to do a lot of the heavy work. Like, so much of the lifting. And I think that's the thing, because, obviously there is...
It was with the timeless child, you know, the master, in effect, being the doctor again, is again drives the master madder. It all kind of culminates in this kind of, you know, okay, fine. If I'm going to be the doctor, I'm going to be the doctor my way. And I'm going to undo everything that the doctor prior did. So, anyway, I apologize. Didn't mean to step over.
No.
I just wanted to finish that point.
No, I was going to say, obviously there is the theory that Dewan's master is pre-Missy. And for what it's worth, I don't think that's what's intended at all. Again, I don't think that's not the kind of thing Chibnall does. But it is easy to claim it, partly because of the weird refusal to ever acknowledge Missy. Like, no reference. Yeah. No, last time I saw you, you were on nothing. Yeah. Like,
last time I saw you, the roles were reversed.
Yeah,
you know?
just a single line. And you're right, you could absolutely sell him as the... I tried to be you, and look what happened to me, and fuck you. You could do that, absolutely. Yeah. Or, you know, but he has to say something about it.
I just
want to
point out, I do have Power of the Doctor playing right now, and it's the Rasputin part, so, the Boney M part. So. when that happened, and I'm old, so I know these songs. When I heard that, I'm like, oh, fuck, and just started belly laughing. And, of course, everybody else who has never heard of Boney M, because none of them are raging Anglophiles like I have been in my life. You know, we're just going, what's wrong with you? And I'm like, it's fucking Rasputin. I bet he had. Anyway, I think the wanting the master to be a pre-Missy master is wishful thinking on fans' parts.
Yeah. But it's so, also... I think...
That's my opinion.
Yeah. No, I get that, absolutely. It is wishful thinking, 100%. But I feel there's an... Again, there's no acknowledgement of what happened. Like, there's a... Like, obviously, Doctor Who has to refresh itself every few years, and you always want lots of fresh jumping on points for people. So, But also, like, he appears, there's... you're still carrying a lot of the viewers from the previous... who would have seen, you know, like, well enough of time watching, like, Spyfall or whatever... And there's no acknowledgement of it at all. And even the Doctor isn't like, oh, thank God, I thought you died in here. The Doctor's like, fuck you. Like, the moment they turn up. And it's like, oh.
I mean, they would acknowledge it. They would at least acknowledge it during the classic series. You know, not always, but, you know.
Oh, yeah. It would be like, well. How did you.
What was Tom Baker's line when you saw Auntie Vanessa and the cop's body? Well, you did escape rocket. Yeah. So, you know.
Well, that's it. And you know, it's like, how did you survive this? And it's like, the whole world knows I'm invincible. That's not a thing, but okay. But yeah, so where was I? Yeah, so but there is an inconsistency in Sata's master himself, because okay, he comes back and his big thing is, I have discovered that you are the timeless child, something we will get to in a moment. But
first,
and this has filled me with rage because there is something of you inside me. Okay, that's not, again, that's given their love-hate relationship, you know, and I do think you have to have the love in there to really balance it out to make it interesting, you know, which is even there in the Pertwee, or at least that sense of friendship between them. Fine. You can make that work, like, if you put some time, again, no time is put into it, but you can make it work, and again, we shouldn't have to be doing all the heavy lifting necessarily, I feel.
Nope.
But then, okay, so he's full of rage, and he literally goes and destroys all of Gallifrey again, because he's so annoyed that there's something of the Doctor within him. And then, okay, fine. Again, it's a bit of a shame that after Gallifrey was previously destroyed in an epic war between the between the Daleks and the Time Lords, that this time around it's destroyed by the Master throwing a stroppy tantrum. But whatever.
Yeah.
Then Power of the Doctor comes back and he's like, I want to be you. And, you know, there's the end when they force his regeneration back and he goes, don't make me go back to being me. Again, really interesting. Hints at something a lot more interesting, that the Master wanted to be himself. This is fine. This is not necessarily contradictory to what we've seen before. It does, however, contradict completely with what we just saw with this Master 2 seasons ago, where he's like, I hate the idea of something being you, and then, like, I'm going to be you. And as, you know, people said, there's the idea of the Doctor regenerating to the Master sounds a really interesting idea, but all it does is involve him basically playing dress up. Like, there's no, again, it's not given any room to breathe. There's no sense of, like, okay, this is what this means. This is why he had to do this and not just pretend to be the Doctor. Like, he could have just gone around being nice to people, going, by the way, I'm the Doctor. Check out me, pullover. who else would be dressed this terribly? But, you know, so it's, again, it's the frustration I have with so much of this era. It's like, interesting ideas are kind of thrown out, and then there's never any sense of room to breathe, anything.
No.
And so nothing means anything to an extent.
Yeah.
And it's just like, oh. And it's like, Sasha, I love, but I think he's a great actor. I see Joe and I, my partner, we watch, or she watches The Great, which is a series about Catherine the Great, set in Russia, actually. And he's in that, and he's brilliant in that. Huzzah! If you watch the show, you'll get that reference. But I kind of wish people had occasionally told him, add layers to it. You don't have to be going 15 out of 10 at all times. It's like, you know, it gets a bit Spinal Tap. This goes up to 11. Well, why don't you just make 11 10? No, this goes up to 11. It's just, and it's annoying because in something like Spyfall, he is great as O. If you go back and watch that, that's a really slightly odd performance. Like, you realise there's something a little bit creepy about him that you can't quite put your finger on. Of course, it makes sense when you know. But I was like, I wish you'd kept playing the Master like that. Like, a bit more Delgado, a bit, you know, that you can have that anger in those moments of, like, rah, that's fine. But you also have to, you do that with some charm or just some oddness or something.
Yeah. It's like you go back and you give it a little bit more panache, a little bit more charm, because when you're going, and I guess the argument could be made that, you know, part of, you know, Dwan's Master is dealing with his own insanity, so that's why he's so prone to these outrageous outbursts and all this. But again, as you say, it's. You know, it gets left up to the fans to do some work here. And it was really funny because you said, you mentioned breathing room, and this is like a 90-minute story, which is, you know, screams breathing room, because, you know, how much padding did we complain about during the classic series, right? You know, well, this 4-6 episode could have been a 4 episode, because, you know, but there's all this breathing room, but it still feels really cramped because there's just so much going on and so little of it is dedicated to Jodie, you know, or dedicated to her doctor. It's, you know,
it's like, when she does, you know, when the regeneration happens and she ends up at the crossroads of forever or whatever it is, you know, and it's lovely to see the other doctors there. It's fine. It's not a bad way to get some cameos in, but then, like, it just, and when she reappears, you know, when she, like, appears in the TARDIS or the hologram appears, you know what I thought it was? I thought, okay, she's communicating to the others via the telepathic circuits, like, it's still her, but it isn't. It's like an AI.
Yeah, it's an AI.
Oh, that's that's a choice, because that was the first thing that popped into my head, was like, oh, telepathic circuit, she's still in the in the mind of the Dr. Master, she's concentrating, she's fighting, and it would be great, at least it would indicate she was still around, she was still fighting, she was proactive in saving herself.
Yeah, instead, you know, Elon Musk was right, so.
I don't know, we're never going to say that. But
no, we're not. That was completely, totally in sarcasm and
jest and
mimicry.
But and it's just, yeah, it's unfortunate. And again, this is the thing where when we do eventually see like Ace and Tegan have any extended conversations with the Doctor, it's with the AI that's looking like their Doctor, which is fine. And it's, look, I am not going to deny, for me, the power, and even the second viewing, despite me being not enjoying it as much, being more frustrated, there's still a moment when it's Sylvester and Soph on screen together, and it's like, oh god, you know, I feel something. I'm not going to pretend I'm like above that. And it's like it's nice seeing, you know, I'm not as big a fifth Doctor fan, though I think I feel the era's a little bit, no, I don't know, misunderstood or underrated, but I still, you know, enough that I can go, oh, okay, though, God knows what most of the audience think about what Adric means. I don't know if they know what that is. But again, it's that frustration of, but why aren't they talking to Jodie? Why aren't they having the... Yeah, it's like Sophie Aldred's book, Childhood's End, where, you know, which is the first... You know, which was the original meeting of Ace and the Doctor, is they have a flashback to like leaving the Seventh Doctor, but they make sure, at least for some of the book's got its flaws, but at least for some of it, there's substantial chunks of her and the 13th Doctor together and talking, and you know, this is how it should be. And actually, the best bit in that book...
Yeah, that I have not read that yet, I do have it done.
I'll tell you what, the best book bit in it is Yaz basically going, are you a terrorist because you have a lot of explosives? And her going, no. And Yaz going, are you sure you're not a terrorist? Basically. I enjoyed that. But you just don't get that here. And even, I mean, obviously I am, you know, a Seventh Doctor fanboy somewhat.
Somewhat. But you've mentioned it once or twice.
I'm going to say, first of all, that final line between them, we're Ace, beautiful, lovely, brilliant. If that's the last we ever see them on screen, and you know, let's acknowledge they've kept working together in Big Finish. This is not like their big reunion, but still, you know, Doctor Who is a TV program ultimately, and there's a power to seeing them on the screen together. That final line, brilliant. However, the Seventh Doctor going, no, blowing up things is bad unless you give fair warning. It's like, what the fuck? I'm sorry? What? There's a planet, Skaro. That would like
it. And a cyber fleet. And
the psychic circus would probably... It feels like a misunderstanding. For me, one of the great things about that era is essentially, particularly once Ace joins, it is essentially... You know, the Doctor tuts and goes, oh, you shouldn't blow things up. And, you know, yes, that's bad. But then he's like, give me some of that Nitro-9 you're not carrying. And he's like, blow up that spaceship. You know, he actually, there is part of the Doctor that enjoys it and loves it. And he would, it just feels wrong for him to say that. And again, somebody said to me, well, you think of it, it's actually the 13th Doctor speaking. And then that moment makes more sense. But it's just, it's such a kind of like, and I know a few other 7th Doctor fans are like, hang on a second. And it's, you know, it's...
Yeah, a thought I just had is, you know, him when you say he enjoys it, and this being the incarnation directly after the Sixth, and the Sixth having dealt with the Valyar, do you think that maybe could be like a reaction of him not wanting to become like the Valyar? Like, if he starts to enjoy the violence, you know, that means he's sliding towards
Valyardian-ishness? It's enjoying the violence, per se. I think it's the joy of seeing something bad blown up, which isn't quite the same thing.
Okay.
You know,
destroying your enemies completely is... I mean, if you fall into a revenge mindset, which, you know, we have to admit, the Doctor does kind of have... has some history with that.
Yeah.
Although we don't want to think that.
It just didn't quite... You know, it was like, oof. It's fine. It's just, it's a little frustrating.
That's an inconsistency.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, that's me being ultra picky. I do accept that to an extent. I mean, I think he gets... to be fair, I think Davison is more Chibnall's doctor as well. If you think of the age he would have been when Davison came on screen and stuff.
Just had a really, really mean thought when you said Davison is Chibnall's doctor. I'm like, so kind of overly nice, bland, and undefined.
Well, you see, I would always argue that his doctor's actually got a lot more bite than that. But yeah, that's the cliche, isn't it?
I mean, he's Terrence Stix could only call him, you know, a friendly open face.
Open face sounds like a medical condition, but
I know, right?
But you know, I think he generally gets the Fifth Doctor sounds a bit more on key because he's probably a bit more of a Fifth Doctor fan. I mean, what on that?
Well, and that makes sense because that's kind of that was, you know, and Moffat the same way because, you know, he did Time Crash. So they kind of, that's kind of their doc. That was the doctor of their era. So where they're growing up. So
Yeah.
So that makes sense. That would make sense.
I mean, I do feel a bit sorry for.
They would write stronger for their doctor, quote unquote.
I do feel a bit sorry for Colin in that he's the only returning doctor. Actually, I guess Bradley doesn't get to appear as the first doctor, dressed as the first doctor. Colin doesn't either, which I feel is cowardly. I also feel it's cowardly that Sasha's costume didn't evolve the Sixth Doctor coat. I was like, oh, come on, you absolute cowards.
you had the chance.
You know.
Well, I think they needed to somehow keep some vestige of Jodie's costume, and I think the coat is like the major signifier. But I think, you know, even maybe a cat badge or something,
yeah, or a cat badge,
the striped trousers,
or the green shoes,
or the spats, yeah, or the spats or whatever, yeah. So, which I have to say. As far as an amalgamation of Doctor Who classic, that was beautiful. I loved it.
I mean,
it's a shame that she didn't wear that for the rest of the story. But
no, it was a good amalgamation. It was fun to see her in it. But of course, the other Doctor we see, at least the hologram pretends to be, is the Fugitive Doctor. And you know, I'm like, Jo Martin's frankly for me the best thing to come out of this era. It's frustrating, as somebody pointed out, that she gets less screen
again. And again, it's not actually her. It's, you know, it's the AI. It's the AI again. So,
I mean, what was it somebody pointed out? She gets less screen time than Rowan Atkinson's Doctor in The Curse of Fatal Death, which feels wrong.
Wow.
That
feels very wrong, but I actually probably... Accurate.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But it also highlights a weird... Again, we're circling back around to Yaz and the Doctor, but I feel that's because that's what so much of this era people have talked about. And Yaz is like, that's weird. You were a travel guide when I last saw you. And I thought, oh God, Yaz has literally gone through this entire time, and she leaves, and she never knows about the Timeless Children or the division. No. The division. And I was like, Yaz still doesn't know what caused the flux.
The doctor doesn't talk
about that. Yaz probably has no idea. I was like, and again, it highlights one of those things that she just doesn't know. I was like, oh.
I love it when you say my name. Anyway, I'm sorry, I'm just watching Ace parachute into the TARDIS, which is kind of a callback to the first episode of The Flux when, you know, Jodie and Yasmin ended up on the mattress together. I have a question. So Ace is carrying the baseball bat. Mm-hmm. It's obviously not the same baseball bat from Remembrance. No. So do we think that maybe she just really... does she have it for any particular reason?
I'll get to that in 2 seconds, but something else to point out. Why is Ace stashed her jacket in the floor of the unit building? And wouldn't it be better if she pulled out a purple air hostess uniform for Tegan and be like, quick, put this on as well.
Quick, put this on. Where are the heels? I got them right here. They're on my sidearms. Anyway.
But no.
Clop, 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 clop.
Just trying to be with them, having to run in that. I was like, fucking hell. Oh, God. That little hat perched on one side.
Yep.
Anyway, sorry. Right, yeah, I just presumed that. Yeah, because you're right, the original. It...
At least there was a canonical explanation for the loss of Nyssa's headpiece in Castrovalva. So, was there ever one for Janet's or for Tegan's air hostess hat?
It's probably still in the TARDIS somewhere. Maybe Shooty will wear it in the next season. He's trying a lot of costumes on.
He's wearing a lot. He's trying on different things. It's interesting.
Yeah,
it's interesting. Can't wait to see this
baseball bat. Yeah, I think. obviously the original the original is destroyed in or gets destroyed in Remembrance. So I guess maybe she just made her own. It seems to be able at least to take out a Dalek eye stalk and look. You know, like we all know what that's referencing. That's fine. But maybe she just got it to spank men like Graham, who she's absolutely in a relationship with now, and I believe, as somebody else said, that this is not my original thought, but in the Doctor Universe, Ace is pegging Graham somewhere tonight. I will say one thing though, it was funny, I had actually more of a reaction to Graham turning up in some ways. I was really happy when Graham turned up. Like, sorry, I'll give you a moment.
Thank you. Wow. Wicked. Anyway.
Gordon Bennett.
Bennett. That's about as I like. Okay. Ooh. Okay. Anyway.
Wow. What was I going to say? God, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was actually really happy when Graham turned up. But kind of, okay, you're going to need a bit longer. Just let me know when you're ready.
Working on it. Oh my god. The scene between Ace and the AI Seventh Doctor is playing out in front of me right now. Anyway, golly. Wow, where do we go from here?
I was saying that, it was actually funny. I remember when I was first watching this, when Graham turned up, I remember actually having a genuine emotional reaction. Like, oh, that's really great. Because, you know, I think Bradley was, you know, maybe because he, you know, unfortunately got a lot of the focus in a way that, you know, was even detrimental to the Doctor. But it's still like, you're like, oh, he's the character from this era that I feel is the most rounded. And hey, here there he is. You know, Bradley Walsh is a very charismatic screen actor. You know, he's able.
Yeah,
to
be... and I love Graham. Yeah, yeah. So, and you know, it's part of being the jokey, awkward father.
Yeah.
Myself, so I know a little bit of that. So, but yeah, the bit where he's holding up the psychic paper. And he's completely inept at it. It's just such a grand moment. But I mean, it's not saying, you know, it's not to his detriment. It's just how endearing he is that, you know, he's that sincere. He can't use psychic paper properly.
But it's also, I think it is a case of he is something of unique to this era that is at least, you know, it at least acknowledges that it's kind of acknowledges that it's Jodie's final episode.
Yeah, and yeah, so it is. It's kind of like a nice dovetail.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It's nice to see him up. But like I said, we also have Vinda returning from Flux. But I genuinely think that Vinda's there because they couldn't get. It's too awkward to get John Barrowman back.
Is Vinda really needed? I mean, outside of it's like whatever the climax is, but you know. There's no other purpose for him to be there except for that.
Just to be there. He's handy and useful, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I just wonder if. I mean, again, we could do a whole episode about Barrowman returning in this era, and then, like, something even went wrong even before, you know, everything kicked off. The fact that his final thing on Revolution of the Daleks is that he leaves via answer phone message, which feels like something went wrong there. I don't know.
I'll film the scene. No, we can just bring in for the ADR. It's okay.
But yeah. Oh, dear.
Yeah, yeah, that makes you wonder. And of course, you know, and this is pretty much, you know, par for the course for this Doctor, but we are not mentioning the Eighth Doctor at all.
Yeah, I get it.
Who I think for me was the highlight of that scene, you know, and you know, he does keep to character, because, you know, the line "I don't do ropes" is just such an Eighth Doctor line. I know we have such little screen time, on screen time with him, because it's probably less than Ruth Martin's Doctor.
Yeah, almost certainly, actually, yeah.
If you think about it. But yeah, or maybe, you know, maybe equal. But I mean, you know, the Eighth Doctor, a lot of his stuff is expanded media, which I know people watching on the BBC are not going to be into. It's us. So, but those of us who have kind of kept up with that aspect or through the books, it's such an Eighth Doctor line, because, you know, if anything, he has his dignity.
Yeah, and you can throw the Eighth Doctor in simply, even if people don't really remember him so much, because obviously, you know, because that TV movie did well over here, so a lot of people did watch it at the time. But also, Paul McGann is a very well known actor, so even if people don't know, they'll be like, oh, it's Paul McGann. They might be confused why he's there, but they'll recognize him as you know, as an actor.
Yeah, so I think, yeah, it was good, and I kind of liked it, because, you know, I think had Tom Baker been there, it would have been kind of an overshadow. And we got our Tom Baker moment in the 50th. And so this is kind of more, you know, the BBC's, you know, for the BBC's benefit of having the extra Doctors.
Yeah, and
so at least that's how I see
and
it.
And it's that thing, isn't it? Because apparently he was asked and he didn't want to do it. And people were a bit grumbly. But I'm like, you know what? He's an old man. Like, he does a big finish, but he can probably do a big finish in the comfort of his home. Like, Tom Baker is a very elderly man, and he maybe doesn't want to come all the way into a studio. And
He's in his late 80s.
And it would have been a far lesser part than what... Like, you're right, what he got in Day of the Doctor is a substantial cameo, and I imagine it would have just been a few lines, probably, in Power of the Doctor. So, yeah, fair enough, he might not want to have gone all the way in and dealt with that. You know, it's a perfectly reasonable...
Because about the only one I could see him replacing, is David Bradley, but you don't want to do that. Because, I mean, you know, he's the amalgamation of Hartnell, Herndahl, and himself as, you know, in that particular, you know, he felt more like the First Doctor to me than in any other previous, you know, well, previous
in,
being...
In a weird way, it's just...
You know,
it's,
the Peter Picaldi's last story, but yeah. But you get what I'm saying.
It's just struck me that actually, in a very weird way, Bradley being in there is the most acknowledgement this era ever did of the Capaldi era, which is... It's interesting. It just occurred to me. I was like, because you're right, even though, you know, he's the First Doctor. And you're right, he would be almost certainly the one that if Tom had come in, it would have been him. Because, you know, you're Tom Baker, or the guy who played a version of the First Doctor once a few years ago. Obviously you're going to go with Tom Baker. But yeah, God, he is the most acknowledgement. Again, I presume it's all classic Doctors, again, which it makes sense.
Well, Kate Stewart as well is an acknowledgement, because she's a Moffat.
I guess she started out Matt Smith, didn't she? So she is.
Well, Smith is well, Capaldi is what.
Yeah, I was thinking more. Right. But you're right. She does. She just spanned.
But she really becomes more who we know from this story in the during the Capaldi era.
That's fair. That's fair. Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but no, that's true.
Yeah.
And again, as I was about to say, it's classic Doctors again, because they didn't know that Tennant was coming back anyway. Smith, Tennant, Capaldi, all busy, all doing a lot of stuff. Like, I imagine I couldn't wait up. I'm pretty certain Smith would have been recording House of the Dragon when this was being done.
Eccleston, no fucks, thank you.
Just like, they,
I mean, and that's...
They approached his door and
he
just got
his
shotgun out and took one quick.
Yeah. Get the fuck off my lawn. I love Peter Capaldi, or sorry, I love Christopher Eccleston so much. And that he has such a... that there's such a fracture between him and the BBC or whatever is just, it's sad. I mean, it's obvious that he loves Doctor Who because he's come back and done the Big Finish audios. And those are fantastic. It's really sad because, you know, we'll never see that Doctor on TV ever again.
No,
that to me is kind of, you know, it's the losses that we've had, you know, from, you know, Hartnell, Troughton, Pertwee, you know, that, you know, somebody who could come back but can't come back, won't come back, is kind of a different thing.
I agree. It is sad. Though I always think at the end of the day, we're not owed any returned appearances. You know, Eccleston gets that 1 year, but it's a great year and he gets some great stories. And
yeah.
But equally, it's just, I do love when he's interviewed about why he's come back to Big Finish and he's went, it's a job. It was just like, they pay me money. I am an actor. I get paid for my performances. But that's the great thing about him. He's very practical.
He's very honest.
He's a great actor.
If you've read his biography, you know that. So.
You know, he
which is very beautiful.
Yeah, no, he's fantastic. But we probably sadly won't get him back on
TV. Yeah. So. Well, definitely not as the Doctor. I don't know. Maybe. We never thought. Never thought H. Freely and Peter Chris would ever rejoin KISS, and they did during the 90s. So.
I will just take your word
for it. I'm grasping here, saying I'm not going to go on my diatribe of Tommy Thayer and Eric Singer being cosplayers and not actual KISS members. So anyway. I mean, give them their own characters, you know? It's like when Peter Criss left, they made Eric Carr the Fox. When Ace Frehley left, Starman, you know, the Starman, they made Vinnie Vincent, like, the Egyptian. So, you know, Peter Criss the cat goes to, you know, the Fox. Anyway.
I feel how other people feel when I drunkenly go, but the thing about Sylvester McCoy's Doctor, which a lot of people don't get, and I just,
Yeah, my girlfriend refers to it as the fire hose. So, and I've done the fire hose on her with Doctor Who when I tried to explain the Morbius doctors and their relation to the Thomas children. Because she watches the new series, she'll watch the new series with me. She's just not a fan of the classic. But I was trying to describe the connection. Apparently enthusiasm took over and she's like, stop, Brian, stop. Anyway.
Well, they're played by Jared Leto and, you know, originally they were great.
Anyway, we've been sidetracked. I enjoyed seeing Paul McGann again. I adore his Doctor, you know, and it's, you know, it's I think if any of the Doctors were to be replaced, it would have been David Bradley's.
And like I said, rightly so. What else is there? It's odd, we haven't, in some ways we keep getting distracted, but I think it's the thing that while there's a lot happening, because is that problem again, there's not a lot to talk about beyond you know, like I will say, okay, Jodie's regeneration scene is brilliant. Everyone says that it's right. That tag, your next great line for her to go out on.
Yeah,
lovely line.
Yeah, which reportedly, apparently, had been the lines had been reversed.
Yeah, and I'm glad because
which is good. It's
a bit snappier that way around. It's a lot snappier. I don't know if you've heard. I have it on. You know how we get rumors about things that were originally thought they might do, because you actually mentioned earlier, no one, when they were shooting this, and you know, Matt Stevens said it in interviews as well, that they didn't know what was coming next. So God.
I'm sorry, I'm watching it's the finale where the old unit building explodes and Kate and Tegan are running out the door as, you know, large amounts of debris and boulders are falling amongst them, and they're only like 20 feet away, maybe, you know, whatever. It's like physics. Sorry. Anyway, it just, as I say, I have it running as we talk, but it was that moment where they're running, it's, you know, they're not really there, so, I'm starting to think this whole TV thing's made
up. Maybe it could be. It's shocking if true. But yeah, so the regeneration, you know, that shot where it pulls back and you see the energy go up, that could have been the last shot for Doctor Who for a long time. Like, genuinely, then that's not a dig at... People think of that as a dig at Chibnall or not. It's not. It's just he generally said... Because it's not his job to sort out what was coming next. So, whatever. Yeah. You know, and I'm sure we're going to get some very interesting books about the 2020 to 2023 period and why certain decisions were made and who were took over. But have you heard... So, sometimes, you know... You get to know people in fandom, you get to get some inside track occasionally, or you know people who are good for rumours that often turn out to be quite accurate. So I did hear that from one source that there was a plan, and I don't think it was ever scripted, but there was serious consideration given to having the Doctor regenerate into a baby in reference to the timeless child, which I just like. But surely that baby...
I don't know if I've
heard
that.
That baby would have then crawled off the cliff and died, so, you know, probably not a great idea. Can you imagine if that had been the final shot of Doctor Who's baby? A baby falling off.
Infanticide, pegging, this episode has it all. except no substitutes, ladies and gentlemen. Harry Sullivan is an imbecile is your podcast for... Hot topics. Anyway, I think, and if the rumors were true, and that had been the last, you know, this had been the last we were going to see a Doctor Who for a while, it would have been, you know, I mean, it's, you know, it doesn't have the I don't know, it doesn't have like the same sense that we get with Survival, you know, with the speech at the end, But yeah, I think, you know, it's from what we've seen of this era, it would be, you know, it'd be just about as good of a send off as you could probably get for this series. You do bring up an interesting thing when you talk about the years, you know, 2020 through 2023 is, you know, as much as we are giving Chibnall and everybody short shrift about everything, you know, what did they have to deal with?
Yeah.
You know, from 2020 to 2022, you know, COVID, you know, a worldwide pandemic where, you know, millions of people died, and yet there's, you know, they're still able to put out a TV show, and, you know, it's, you know, the enormous, you know, enormously complicated to do a TV production normally.
Yeah.
You know, trying to do it during a pandemic is, you know, it's, you know, 4D chess, you know, plus a bit of performance art, you know? it's just...
And, yeah, I absolutely get what you're saying. And I do agree, it's very difficult circumstances to make a TV program, 100%.
And that's not an excuse. Mm. It's just an acknowledgement of what's been... What goes on. What has happened.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is... Absolutely. I was going to say, the trouble is, it was ended up with people who... trying to make Doctor Who under very difficult circumstances, who were having trouble making Doctor Who under pretty decent circumstances. And so it's like it's a miracle that we got Flux. It's a miracle, you know, they could...
This is
you
true,
know,
and, yeah.
But also, yeah, it's not... Yeah, it's you know, you're right, it's not an excuse, but it does explain some decisions. But I don't know if you ever read Sage Young's review of Legend of the Sea Devils. Really good. Head over heels, I think it's on. And if I would really recommend it. It's a wonderful summary of the kind of frustration with this era and with being a fan, but also that kind of frustration that came up with people going, "Oh, you shouldn't criticize because of this, and this." And partly because, you know, obviously no one wanted to be one of the not my Doctor types, and I get it. But it's like, but at the end of the day, which is a terrible summary of the article. It's really good. It's just one of these pieces of writing I go back to when I'm trying to... I reread it a bit when I was trying to...
We'll link to it. We'll link to
it. Yeah. If you look up Sage Young, Legend of the Sea Devil, you know, it'll come up. It's just... And I think that it also sums out how I feel about this era. Like... And I know it's always... it's almost impossible to talk about this episode without just talking about the era as a whole.
Yeah.
And I feel it's just... I was so, like, I wasn't a huge Chibnall fan, and, you know, like, the Capaldi era was, in some ways, my era of 100%, I adore it. But I was like, I'm ready for change, this is cool. And the first female doctor, I was like, fucking fantastic, about time, brilliant. And in some ways, it isn't fair that they were always going to face more criticism because of that. They were always going to face more criticism for having more diversity on screen. Which they shouldn't do, because more diversity on screen is brilliant. More diversity behind the scenes, long overdue. You know, like, people go, what do you want carrying on from the Chibnall era into the new, whatever you want to call it, Bad Wolf era, RTD2, whatever. Because, you know, the BBC Wales era is also over. No one's really discussed that, but it interests me. But, and what I want carried on, and what a lot of people have said, is that diversity. Greater diversity in writers, greater diversity on screen. And I think we're going to get that. I think, you know, I mean, Shooty is like massive.
I mean, Jinx on soon.
Yeah, I love Jinx. I'm so looking forward to that.
I mean, we're getting all sort of, yeah, I mean, and this is not new territory for the modern series, because we dealt with this, some of this stuff during, you know, the first RTD era, because, you know, it's a lot of people don't seem to remember the complaints of the gay agenda and all that stuff. And, you know, where there would just be like one or two mentions of, oh, it's his husband. And they're like, oh my God, they're trying to turn this gay. It's like you say, diversity is good. I mean, we get definitely for you and I, because we're both, you know, white males, you know, we get viewpoints that we don't necessarily see, because, you know, we're not women, or, you know, we're not from, you know, a non-European, you know, descent or anything like that. So, you know, and I like it, because, you know, why do we love Neil Gaiman? Because there's so much, you know, mythology and sources and depth that goes into his stories. It's multicultural and everything like that. It just, you know, and then you have more stories to tell, you know, because, you know, you have different mythologies to pull from and interpret and all this stuff. And so, you know, it's just kind of, you know,
yeah.
I don't feel like we get that with the Chibnall era
as much. And this is what I was saying, like, you know,
I mean, we get the diversity, but we don't necessarily get, you know, as much of the depth. Yeah. I mean, obviously the diversity is there with Tosin Cole and Mandeep, and, you know, we have our first, you know, woman doctor, that's not Joanna Lumley, and we acknowledge that, but it just, I don't know.
Well, yeah, and I think my thing is, like I said, you know, it is unfair that he got criticism for that, you have to know when you're doing something like the first female doctor, you are going to have to go extra hard on getting everything right. And that's not fair.
Yeah.
That's really unfair, because not every Doctor Who episode has to be a stone cold classic. You can do basically entertaining TV. But sometimes this is an era that falls down on that as well. It's just like you have to bring, it's unfair, but you have to bring your A plus 5-star go at it. You really do. And if you don't, you're just giving more fuel for the shit. You know?
And that's not to say everything about this era is bad. You know, and obviously we haven't said that. One of the things I really like about this era are, you know, the monsters are so much more interesting, you know, like Azure and Swarm and Tim Shaw, you know, these are not, you know, these are, you know, like, we've not seen these kind of monster, you know, designs before. So, the Santarans were freaking brilliant. It's great to see Santarans that looked like, you know, the classic series Santarans, and not, you know, what we have previously, which, you know, nice design, nice upgrades, which, you know, is what this series has been all about in terms of its classic monsters. But, you know, it's I like that Chibnall at least kept classic looks, you know, because we got to the look, you know, we kept the modern series Daleks, obviously, but that's a classic, you know, a a iconic look, shall we say. You know, we had ended up with a very iconic look to the Cybermen, you know, with the expanded headset. You know, the Sea Devils almost could not even tell. It looked anything different than what we, you know, than the original costumes that we had.
He should have
before.
Updated the Sea Devils, and the though. Santaris. He should have updated the Sea Devils, because it was just like, that's a lump of rubber. Oh, dear.
But it's done so much better than it was.
I'm
in the
actually
classic
not sure
series,
the Sea Devils
in my
were,
opinion.
Yeah. No, and I mean it.
I mean, better than the classic series. I mean, definitely better than Warriors. And
weirdly
the
enough, it turns out that Chibnall's quite a good Sontaran writer, which I didn't see coming.
Ooh, there
but
you, go.
You know,
it's because he loves chocolate.
You know, I mean, I can almost forgive this era all its sins for, and I wanted to ride a horse. You know, it's just something like, but yeah, you know, it's, I don't know. I'm not trying to sum up all my thoughts on the Zero and it as a whole. I think, you know, you can listen to this episode and just see where I'm going with it. But it's just been a time of frustration for me. I found it, you know, more frustrated than happy, which is not how I like to approach my Doctor Who. And it, you know, it does lie at the door. Of the showrunner at the end of the day, like,
and you know, we've heard the, you know, Radio Fuscaro episode, you know, interview with him, and you know, obviously other interviews that you've done, and you know, it's not easy running a TV series.
No.
I mean, we can't. I mean, we can barely run a podcast. We can barely manage a podcast, but I say that in jest, but yeah, it's not easy. But at the same time, so I'm reading You Got Blood on You, which is a book about the making of Shaun of the Dead, and it talks about, you know, everything that Edgar Wright, you know, consumed media wise and films and all that, to, you know, kind of to, and the amount of work, insane work that he put in to writing the script for Shaun of the Dead, and then storyboarding it, and like getting every single shot. I mean, even the cut, you know, the really cut, quick cuts that he does. Mm. you know, it's so, I mean, it's really, you see how much effort goes into, how much effort someone can put into it. And then, you know, we kind of see, you know, some of what we get with the Chibnall era, where, you know, storylines are just dropped, you know, and or ignored or not acknowledged, or just, you know, it's frustrating, because, you know, what could have been, you know, what, you know, there's speculation, you know, is RTD going to acknowledge the Timeless Child? Some say yes, some say no. I don't care. you know, I just want good stories in the end, is always, you know, with Doctor Who, that is always my base need, is that it's a Doctor Who story. It feels like a Doctor Who story. And so, yeah, this is, you know, these have been Doctor Who stories, but, you know, it's like I said, there could have been so much more. There just could have been just so much more done, just with this Doctor alone, to say nothing of, you know, Ryan or Graham or Yaz or Dan, you know.
Yeah.
You know, we get as much depth as we do with them, and, you know.
And, I mean, you know what? I think that's a good place to end it. I think.
I believe. I am agreeing. Yeah. I'm agreeing. We said it wasn't going to be 90 minutes, but
it's
almost been
90 minutes.
It's 90
Maybe
minutes.
Maybe we'll let it a few bits out. Maybe so it'll be under.
And I'm just coming up as the regeneration's happening. And, hey, look, that's not Shuri Gatwa. What's going on here? So, yeah, that's, yeah, and we'll touch on the controversy of clothes regenerating with the Doctor after we see the anniversary special.
Yes,
so.
Yeah. We'll
but thank you for joining us, and I hope you've enjoyed this episode. You can find us on Twitter at imbecilepod. We are online. Imbecile.wordpress.com is our blog. Sometimes we blog. Mostly it's our episodes. I am working on a post for about the Doctor Who USA tour that came through the U.S. like in 87, 88. So I have some artifacts from that I'm going to be putting up. So I've been working on this article for a while, so that'll be going up. So keep an eye out for that. Leave us a review on your podcast device, your podcast device would be your phone, or your computer, but, whatever app you use. We're on iTunes. Anything else? I mean, is there anything else?
Hang on, sorry, give me 2 seconds.
Whoops!
That's not good.
Uh-oh.
I was just, sorry, I'm recording everything, but it's just a bum bike. It was on the floor. Yeah, through it. Hang on. Sorry,
that's okay,
small
good.
Dog. So I totally choose. bless it.
That's been this episode. So, but, we're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, we're on WordPress. You know, come see us online, talk to us on Twitter. I am at Gonzaro, and you are
Adam J. Kleck, I think. Oh, that he says like a man who isn't on Twitter all the time. But you know, he's
says a man who's confident in his.
Yep,
his
Adam J. Kleck. You can catch me there. I'm still on there, riding that hell train to the end. Toot toot.
Yep, me too. I'm Slim Pickens in Doctor Strangelove. I'm riding this bomb down to the end. Oh, what fun the end of capitalism, late stages of capitalism, have turned into. So, anyway. All right, well, Adam, it has been great, and I can't hear you. There you are.
Still
are
here.
Okay, there you are. Now I can hear you. Okay, cool. Anyway, so thanks for tuning in. We're going to be continuing. Not sure what we're going to be doing our next episode, but it's either going to be a look at the next Ian Martyr Target novelization, which is Sontaran Experiment, or we'll be continuing our look at the 11th Doctor comics with the second series. So, or it may be something completely different. Who knows? Hey, why do we need to, like, you know, keep to, like, a certain set? You know, let's be free, you know, carpe diem, Dead Poet Society, you know? It's all standing on our desks and quote Walt Whitman.
Yeah, carpe diem, seize that fish.
All right, well, thank you so much for listening, y'all, and we'll catch you next time.
Bye.